Welcome to the Heavy Spoilers Show. I'm your host, Definition, and if you've been watching The Watchmen and have questions about the first episode, as well as where the show could be heading, then this is the video for you. Throughout, we'll be recapping all of the first episode of HBO's Watchmen and discussing where things could be going in the future. There will be heavy spoilers here, so if you haven't got Dr. Manhattan's ability to see everything at once and don't want anything ruined, then I highly recommend that you turn off now. With that out of the way, I just want to give a huge thank you for clicking this video. Now let's get into our breakdown of Watchmen. Okay, so similar to the original graphic novel, Watchmen jumps about from time setting to time setting with relative ease, showcasing different moments in the story at different times. The majority of the storyline in episode 1 takes place 30 years after the original graphic novel, and due to the events of the book, the world is a vastly different one to the one we know. Robert Redford has been president for 3 decades, Dr. Manhattan now lives on Mars, and Rorschach has become a symbol for white supremacy. In addition to this, police officers now wear yellow masks to protect their identities after an incident known as the White Night, in which criminals tracked down the officers outside of working hours and shot them in their homes. Throughout, there's an undertone of people being forced to hide their identities in order to protect their beliefs, and it's one of the main driving forces of the narrative. Our introductory story mirrors this masked identity aesthetic and begins in Tulsa 1921 with a young boy watching the story of a hooded vigilante taking down a villain. The character is revealed to be Bass Reeves, one of the first ever black US Marshals, who stands strong as a role model for the young onlooker, as similar to Reeves, he is also African American. Now, this is a time period in which there was little representation of other races on screen, and the joy that the boy finds from seeing a hero looks like him is short-lived when his parents pick him up and escort him outside into a riot scene headed up by the KKK. These white supremacists wiping out a predominantly black city because of their way of life acts as the origin story for the young boy, and it instantly cements the work as something special. Anyone who's ever read a comic before will notice the instant similarities to Bruce Wayne, with both watching a hero on screen in a theater before the death of their parents. Bruce had Zorro, the boy has Bass Reeves, and both have a childhood fraught with tragedy that has inspired them to take a certain pathway in life. We watch as the boy walks down a long road, holding the only other survivor of the massacre, which just so happens to be a baby. Instantly, you get the gravitas of the situation, and we are then propelled to present day, where we once again witness another confrontation that is steeped in racial politics. This involves a traffic stop on the same road, however here the dynamics are polar opposites, with the cop being a black man and the person in the car being white. We discover that the policeman and the man being stopped both use masks, and thus they represent symbols of their respective sides and beliefs. After the cop discovers that the man during the stop is a member of the 7th Cavalry, the group that apparently follows Rorschach, the situation escalates into a shootout, with the policeman being brutally shot several times whilst he sits in his car. It really kickstarts the show with a level of drama and tension that instantly lets you know that the season isn't pulling any punches. Whereas the original graphic novel focused on the threat of nuclear war, the HBO adaptation very much centers around a potential race war that is a clear comment on modern society. After the policeman's wife, Roberta Sutton, is informed of the shooting, we learn the backstory of how police live in fear of retaliation and have to lie about their jobs in order to remain safe. Now, one of the main things that stopped the policeman from being able to retaliate during the stop is that there exists a law which all police must adhere to. In order to draw their weapon, policemen must first get permission from their superiors, and from the off, I believe that this stands strong as a statement that there should actually be measures in place to stop innocent bystanders being shot by trigger-happy police. This law comes into question though when the 7th Cavalry release a video discussing how the black accumulated filth will be hosed from the streets of Tulsa, and they will be turned into extended gutters overflowing with liberal tears. This has clear allusions to the original speech from Watchmen made by Rorschach, and though they have misinterpreted his words as their message, similar to their idol, I doubt there will be any compromises. They utter tick tock repeatedly, and we get the feeling that, like Watchmen, the doomsday clock is ticking down. It's clear that we need something more powerful than police to stop the threat, and this comes in the form of a superhero known as Sister Night, aka Angela Abar. She is an ex-policewoman that was shot during the White Night and now masquerades as a vigilante, hunting down the cavalry. Angela pretends to run a bakery, but you do get the feeling that this will be revealed to be a front later in the show, as it's never open and onlookers often remark about its lack of customers. Sister Night works with the police, who have several other vigilantes in their ranking, and this includes a panda and also a character known as Looking Glass, who may or may not be a cavalry mole. This guy is pretty much the Rorschach of the show, and it's awesome seeing him interrogate a cavalry member brought in by Sister Night. Now, what this interrogation implies is that there's an undercurrent of society that believes that the original squid attack from the graphic novels is a hoax. It also shows that the police have methods of interrogation that can indicate whether someone is lying or telling the truth. There's a nice little nod to Rorschach being a big figure in the prison, with urine running from behind a closed door, but overall it indicates that perhaps the brutality in order to get the truth method is still very much in place. This leads to a raid on a cattle farm, which is by far the episode's high point. The cavalry become aware of the infiltration and go Rambo on the police and heroes whilst trying to escape. It's an awesome set piece that shows that this series is going to pack some big punches and that life as a masked hero has a lot of dangers. However, they have the means to fight back, and watching the police get their own Archie in order to chase down the cavalry's ride is outstanding. We also learn of Ozymandias' fate, and after the staged alien attack, the character faked his own death and now lives in the countryside, waited on hand, leg and foot by his android servants. He gets a big yellow and purple birthday cake, which fans of the comics will know are his colours, but there's a hint of sadness to the detachment from society. He is presented a watch which reminds him that there's a countdown to the end of the world that he must intervene in, similar to how he did in the source material. He mentions a play he is writing called The Watchmaker's Son, which is a reference to Dr. Manhattan, who was also the son of a watchmaker. Now, where this storyline goes remains to be seen, but the episode concludes by divulging that Sister Night and the police captain are friends outside of work, and that there is also a bigger mystery going on. That is the cavalry's mission, and I love how there's a ticking clock in the background of the finale that cements that everyone is living on borrowed time. This includes the police captain, who in the episode's big twist is captured and killed during a call-out. When exiting his car, there's a strobe light flashing, and this may indicate that Looking Glass could be behind the attack. It's definitely part of his toolkit, and he is someone that would have access to the captain's itinerary, so would, therefore, know which road that the character would be travelling on. Angela discovers his body after being called out to it by the disabled man that was outside of her bakery, and we see the blood drip down onto his police badge, similar to the blood splash that dropped on the comedians in the original work. This closes out the episode, and the note left with the disabled man hints that someone may know that Angela and Sister Night are one in the same. Going forward, I do think that we will discover there is a mole within the organization, and that the cavalry will continue their attacks, eventually leading to a face-off between the two sides. I think that the man in the wheelchair will be revealed to be the boy from the beginning of the episode, and he may possess some powers that we are yet unaware of. It looks like Ozzy is ramping up to unleash an attack on civilization to once again unite them, and this could definitely lead to more disruption in the future. Either way, I'm massively excited for what's to come, and I can't wait to watch episode 2 next week. But what did I think of the episode overall? Well, I did have some difficulty fully getting into it, as I feel certain aspects were slightly heavy-handed, such as the whole police being good, white people being bad thing. This kind of struck a nerve with me, as I think police in general are definitely a main factor in racial tensions across America, with there being so many that are involved in the deaths of innocent black people. However, casting that aside, as far as first episodes go, this was enjoyable, and I definitely had a lot of fun returning to this world, especially after I was left so disappointed by the DC sequel, Doomsday Clock. Overall, I think this has a lot of good things in store, and I can't wait to see what happens in the future of Watchmen. Now, obviously, I'd love to hear your thoughts on Watchmen Episode 1 and where you want to see the show go in the future. Comment below and let me know, and if you enjoyed this video, then please like it. And make sure you check out our full podcast, which goes through every issue of The Watchmen one by one and breaks down everything that you need to know about them. It's the ultimate podcast for fans of the series, so hopefully I see you over there after this. If you want to come chat to me after the video, then make sure you follow me on Twitter at DefinitionYT, or head over to my Discord server, which will be linked in the description below. Those are the best ways to keep up to date with all the latest videos on the channel, so hopefully I see you over on there soon. We're also giving away a free copy of the Marvel Phase 3 Part 1 box set on Blu-ray, which contains Civil War, Doctor Strange, Homecoming, Ragnarok and more, and all you have to do to be in with a chance of winning is to like the video, make sure that you subscribe to the channel and leave your thoughts on Watchmen in the comments section below. The winner is going to be chosen on the 15th of November and the set will be shipped out from then to whoever gets the prize, so best of luck to everyone who takes part. This is a channel for people who are super into superheroes, so if that's the kind of thing you like, hit subscribe. Thanks again for taking the time to watch this. I've been Definition, you've been the best, and I'll see you next time. Take care, peace.